performing counter-monumentality. If we understand 2014 as a threshold year for the challenge to systemic racism in U.S. institutions, particularly the criminal justice system and policing, then the years following saw an increased critique of public monuments to white supremacy. Motivated by the ska-pick violence, implicit in the numerous pictures of Dylan Roof, murderer of 9 black parishioners of Mother Emanuel Church in Charleston, South Carolina, posing against backdrops of Confederate flags and other symbols of the Confederacy, many citizens took to the streets to challenge all manner of monuments to the Confederacy, making the case that these symbols are overt affirmations of white supremacy. The government of South Carolina voted to remove the Confederate flag as its state flag and take him down NOLA, gained steam, and successfully removed the statue of Robert E. Lee that sat in the heart of New Orleans. Across the U.S. South in cities such as Charlottesville, Virginia, and even on university campuses such as the University of Texas at Austin and the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, Confederate statues and tributes to the Confederacy were and continue to be removed from public spaces. In addition to activist efforts toward removal, we see increasing performances of what contemporary art critics and archaeologists such as James Osborne call counter-monumentality, the construction of monuments that are specifically intended to challenge monuments' conventional tropes of scale and celebration. End quote. Osborne goes on to theorize counter-monumentality, asserting, counter-monuments thus embody qualities quite opposite from conventional monuments. A. Instead of being permanent, they can be fleeting and transitory. B. Rather than glorifying their subject, they problematize it. And C. As opposed to being a static representation for the viewer to observe, they actively invite and require viewer participation and engagement. End quote. Such anti-monumental practices, as Osborne would have it, also highlight the counterintuitive frailty of memory inherent in monuments. Writers of U.S. literature have drawn upon anti-monumental practices in their reflections on the Civil War and the aftermath of this history across time. Confronting the way the Civil War has been memorialized in public spaces, authors such as Alan Tate, James Lowell, and Kevin Young, in addition to Parks and Trethewey, have taken up the subject, contextualizing it in their contemporary moments. While analyses of how this plays out in U.S. poetry abound, the work of drama and performance in this area demands greater critical attention, particularly as it most thoroughly reflects the possibilities for literary anti-monumental practices. Performances expressive force documents and urges critique of institutional monuments, especially since, as generations pass, these sentiments toward the past often shift. It also allows for voices marginalized out of the conversation in the early fabrication and installation of the institutional monuments and associated narratives to place themselves in dialectic relation with these objects. This process makes possible a reframing of such tributes to, and accounts of the past via the stage or performative practice that interpolates new sentiment embedded within the monuments. Drawing on discourses that interrogate the unreliability of the historical archive and performances' disruption of that perceived stability, I read Trethewey's and Parks's work through these lenses to uncover how Native Guard and Father Comes Home from the Wars represent quintessential counter-monuments to the Civil War. These works create a dialogic relationship to monuments and historical discourses that bring into greater view Black experience and respond to the veritable erasure of Black perspectives from Civil War memory and history. In the performance space, these works produce a different archive of public effect that counters archival practices of containment. These living monuments, then, account for repressed histories and are in themselves implicit critiques that raise questions about the meaning of freedom and the reliability of the archive, thereby causing audiences to question all of the history they are taught in educational institutions. Michelle Rolfe Trio highlights the problems of approaching history from a positivist, singular narrative that doesn't account for multiple subjectivities. He also reminds us that present and past are always in dialectical relation, and that the past is only past because there is a present. End quote. Hartman also posits that a thinking through of the present requires engagement with the past. The stakes of such a project are critical for Black subjects negotiating what she calls the afterlives of slavery, whose voices have often been left out of these critical narratives. She explains the necessity of trying to represent what we cannot, rather than leading to pessimism or despair, must be embraced as the impossibility that conditions our knowledge of the past and animates our desire for a liberated future. End quote. Moving this conversation to the realm of performance, Diana Taylor and Suzan-Lori Parks offer valuable analytics through which to explore possibilities for critically examining the institutional archive. In referring to how performances, cultural, informal, or formal, carry history, Taylor argues that the intangible storehouses of history and memory held within these performances should be read as the repertoire as opposed to an institutional archive. Challenging the authority of the written word, Taylor explains that repertoires of performance democratize knowledge and function as vehicles that transmit histories and transform choreographies of meaning across time. When it comes to performing and representing slavery, especially in theater, questions of time are thrown into critical relief in many ways. First, the stage is a fluid temporal space where histories are constantly performed again and again, with audiences suspended in time during the performance. Yet, with each performance, a new experience is produced, so that no two performances are presented in the exact same way. Moreover, the stage, with its transtemporal capacity to play with time, makes it a dynamic space in which to stage slavery. Slavery is itself an event that cannot be contained by a conventional understanding of time. Calvin Warren generatively offers the framework of black time as an alternative temporality of slavery, which he elaborates as time without duration. It is a horizon of time that eludes objectification, foreclosing idioms such as getting over, getting through, or getting beneath. End quote. In positing a new mode for understanding time in relation to slavery, Warren refuses a static demarcation of past and present, beginning and end.